The Book of Mormon, another testament of Jesus Christ and record of God's dealings with some of the ancient inhabitants of America, begins with the story of Lehi and his family who leave Jerusalem just before the Babylonian takeover. But while they are in the wilderness, they realize they forgot something very important, something that would help them to remember the commandments of God and to keep their written language. The scriptures, which were written on brass plates, which I guess were the only ones in Jerusalem at the time, which were being held by Laban, of all people, a rich nobleman of sorts. And so Lehi commanded Nephi and his other brothers, Laman, Lemuel, and Sam, to go into the city and get them. So they came to Laban, they presented some of their riches, and were like, we'll trade you these for your brass plates. But Laban just kicked them out and took all their stuff. And so Nephi went back alone, following the spirit, and he found Laban drunk on the ground, and he was suddenly told by the spirit to kill Laban right then and there, while he was drunk and unarmed and totally defenseless. So he chopped off Laban's head, got the brass plates, and while pretending to be Laban wearing his clothes, took the servant also. And then he and his family traveled to the Americas, where his descendants and Laban's descendants split off from each other and had lots of different wars all over the millennia until Laban's seed just obliterated Nephi's seed. But going back to Nephi going in and killing Laban, there's a lot of controversy around that. A lot of people are very uneasy about the whole situation. Though, according to Dr. Hugh Nibley, those who are familiar with nighttime patrolling in wartime will see in Nephi's tale a convincing and realistic account. Though the main point of criticism here is questioning why Nephi would be commanded to kill an unarmed man to begin with. Many, it seems, are not satisfied with the answer the Book of Mormon gives, that it is better that one man should perish than an entire nation should dwindle and perish in unbelief. This is very unusual for us modern Westerners, but in the Middle East, and especially back then, it was a regular thing. It is important to remember that Laban was no innocent man. He stole the property of Nephi and his brothers and sought to kill them. We can reasonably assume that Nephi's killing of Laban was justified back then. When Nibley was teaching a class full of Arab students and told the story, the response was not, why did Nephi kill Laban? The response was, why did Nephi wait so dang long? Why didn't he just do it and get it over with as quickly as possible? Though despite this, there was an interesting video put out by Radio Free Mormon, who puts forth a profound idea that this is actually a lesson in being overly obedient to the Spirit of God. His reasoning begins by talking about how Nephi's seed are the ones to perish instead of Laman and Lemuel's, the less righteous brothers. In one sense, it doesn't make sense. And it's not fair that Nephi's seed should perish since he was the righteous brother. So perhaps his punishment for killing Laban was that, yeah, his seed were going to perish. His desire to be overly obedient to God proved to be his downfall. I am suddenly reminded of the Garden of Eden, in which Adam and Eve partake of the forbidden fruit and break the law that God gave them. But that act itself is what allowed their seed to come into being and endured up until now. It is a profound idea indeed that being overly obedient to God could be a bad thing, and that God wants us to exercise our agency and, you know, be a little bit disobedient at times. Wisdom, then, is knowing how and when to disobey, and to what degree. I am sure that such times are extremely rare, however. As convincing as Radio Free Mormon, or RFM's, argument is, I do have a few issues with it. He paints a bleak outlook on life and casts doubt. The Nephites went extinct at the end of the story, not because their ancestor from a very long time ago decided to kill one bad man. I mean, we're talking at least 1,000 years apart. But because, I mean, they were killed off because of their own sins. They were raping, they were killing, they were being cannibals. So, yeah, I think it would have been their own sins is why they got killed off. It just seems a ludicrous stretch to suggest that Nephi's killing of Laban and over-obedience to God was the set-off to the payoff of his prosperity in the long-distant future being abolished. If it was a snowball effect, there seems to be no through line to connect the dots. RFM depicts Nephi as a Macbeth type who killed Laban out of greed, as Macbeth killed the king. The problem is that Nephi is never depicted as being greedy, just because he observed that Laban had a shiny sword. I don't think that's justification enough. Nephi just wanted the brass plates and did what he had to do to get them. He didn't even attempt to take over Laban's estate like a Macbeth. I don't think we can entirely say that Nephi's slaying of Laban was a bad thing, as, you know, according to Hugh Nibley, it was totally a normal thing to kill somebody like Laban back then. And by decapitating him, it was supposed to be quick, painless, and as safe as possible to, you know, decrease the amount of pain that Laban would have otherwise felt by a different means of death. Though, despite all this, I still find it a profound idea to speculate on whether or not it is possible to be overly obedient to God. I mean, after all, Latter-day Saints are famous and well-known for praising Adam and Eve for disobeying God in the Garden of Eden by partaking of the forbidden fruit. So, but, you know, what do you think? Comment your comments in the comment section and like the video so that this video comes up on other people's feeds. Subscribe to the channel to help the channel to grow, and remember to keep it righteous.